Hello and welcome to another episode of It Could Have Been a Classic. Sorry, I've not been on for a while. I've moved, my house is half done. I'm very happy with how things are going. And I'm feeling better after the nightmare neighbour from upstairs. So anyway, enough of all that. I've moved on. I'm feeling positive. And hello, YouTube, and welcome to It Could Have Been a Classic. Right, so there goes the introductions. I've not made a video for 2 weeks, and I tried making this morning, actually, since 11 o'clock, and it's 1 o'clock now. I've had a load of phone calls and messages, and I'm finally going to get on with it. So let's get into Chris Boucher's 1987's Star Cops. Star Cops is a weird one. So shall we go into the history of Star Cops? Let's take a look. This is where I do some cheating by looking at Wikipedia. Star Cops is a British science fiction television series broadcast on BBC Two in 1987. It was devised by Chris Boucher, a writer who had previously worked on science fiction television series Doctor Who, the decent Doctor Who, and Blake Seven, a classic, one of my all-time favourite series, as well as crime dramas such as Juliet Bravo, my family used to watch that, and Bergerac. So Star Cops is set in the year 2027, a time where interplanetary travel has become commonplace. It starred David Calder as the excellent Nathan Spring, commander of the International Space Police Force, nicknamed the Star Cops, who provide law enforcement for the newly developing frontier and the colonies of the solar system. The series follows Nathan Spring and the rest of his multinational team as they work to establish the Star Cops and solve whatever crimes comes their way, operating relatively accurately realized hard science fiction, sci-fi near future space environment. Many of the cases that the Star Cops investigate arise from opportunities for new crimes presented by the technologically advanced future society. Series depicts and from the hostile frontier of the environment that Star Cops live in. 9 episodes were made. There was going to be a 10th episode, but there was a strike, plus there was a lot of politics in the background. Chris Boucher walked after 5 episodes, and they got other writers in. The director was called, I forgot, Evie Gidney or something. The didn't get on, apparently. If you watch The Cult of Star Cops, which is on YouTube, it will explain a lot of what went on. The series, I started watching it again this week. Now, I do have it on DVD, and the DVD is going for stupid money. Now, the producer, Evgeny Grignev, that's how it's pronounced. So there you go. So I just thought I'd get the producer in. But him and Chris Boucher didn't really get on. So anyway, back to the story of Star Cops. There we go. Right. Spacemen are ten a penny. What they need out there is a good copper, Commander Nathan Spring. The Commander, Star Cops, in episode 1, An Instinct for Murder, written by Chris Boucher. Star Cops, obviously 27, 40 years from 1987. It's right. Law and order is provided by the International Police Force, ISPF. 20 part-time volunteers, disparagingly nicknamed Star Cops. The decision has been made to put the ISPF on permanent full-time footing, and a new commander, Nathan Spring, has been appointed to accomplish this. Many of the series episodes deal with Spring's efforts to establish the Star Cops. He sets up a base of operations on the moon base, recruits new staff, roots out and dismisses the corrupt officers, and works to extend the Star Cops' reach, first into the American space stations, then end of the series, the far-flung reaches of the Mars colonies, all the while investigating whatever crimes come along the way. So, like, you've got Mackenzie, she's Australian, I think she starts off being a bit dodgy, actually. But then there's, like, this terrorist thing where they hold this space shuttle going to the moon, and she says they're going to blow it up, and she saves it and gets reinstated. And Aaron Spring, there's a bit of sexual tension going on. It is quite funny because he's quite a civilized man and she's a bit crazy, but it sort of works wonderfully. You've got Davis, he's like, he's not like racist at all. His stereotypes, everything, you know, is a bit thick. But you love Davis, but he says things very black and white. Do you know what I mean? And you've got Fido is second in command. He's American. I really liked his character. He's like, when Spring turns up and like gets rid of all corrupt ones and all that in the first episode, he makes him his second in command because he's quite an honourable man. He's like, because he's a policeman and that. And it's basically, this all starts off like, there's some amazing crimes in this because like, there's an episode where the mafia and nicking uranium from the moon and take, it's meant to be getting dumped nuclear waste out in outer space. And they go and investigate the mafia, but they're sneaking uranium back to Earth to sell to factions or different countries. And they put a stop to that. And in comes the politics now, because like this new organization, these outer space police Star Cops, they're starting to step on people's toes now. Because their job is to police the frontier, basically, because we're expanding out. And we're at Mars. And we might even be beyond Mars. We could be on the moons of Jupiter, you know, like Titan or Europa and places like that, you know, which is sort of interesting. Forgive me if I've got the planets wrong or the moons in the wrong location. But so we know there's colonies on Mars, which... I'll go into this in a second, but like he's got his like his, there's like it's based on the four characters, and obviously you see people in the background, and he decides to put the center of operations on the moon, which makes sense. And every week he's got like in there, he's got one episode, they've got to get the Americans on board so they can expand their influence across all the space stations, you know, which are needed. Excuse me. So they expand all the space, like their influence from Russians to the Americans, the British, and all this. And like each episode, there's political intrigue, there's a crime going on. But some of the crimes are quite amazing. Like there's embryos, somebody steals this billionaire woman's embryos and starts like burning them because apparently on the moon it's better to store them there and all this. And they really go into it. But the characters are really good. By episode five, I think it's episode four or five, we get a Russian director who runs the moon base, which is sort of interesting. And then we get a Japanese doctor. And it's quite a very international cast of characters within all this. You know, I mean, there's a story with Japanese corporations and how they run the corporates really strict. I mean, I will say for the time... there is a lot of stereotype because Davis sort of like uses the stereotype thing. Today, you won't be able to get away with that, but this was made in 1987. But it starts off Nathan Spring, his wife gets murdered and there's a big cover up and he investigates it and he brings it all down and he becomes head of Star Cops. And then second episode, it's getting the team together. And it's sort of interesting. There's one with like these space suits that have been sabotaged, which is interesting. But one of my favourite ones is the Ronald Reagan space station, where the Americans have been messing about with like germ warfare, because it's like, we know gravity in space. And they dump one of the parts of the space station and some people find it. And he's trying to get in on to get their like authority spread right across the five main space stations in orbit over Earth and all the smaller ones and the moon and Mars. It makes sense. You're going to put a police force out there. It's funny, really, because the film Outland was sort of like this at a point. You know, with Sean Connery, which is a classic film. At some point, I'm going to have to watch that again. Where it's set in on like one of the moons of Jupiter. You know, which I've not seen Outland in a long time. So, like, it's sort of, you can see connections. So every episode is, like, dealing with these highly advanced crimes that are, and the moon's being used to, like, either smuggle stuff or bring stuff out and organise their getting their influence out there and corporation. I mean, it's like it's a free-for-all on this big frontier. But the series is very good. I mean, scientifically, I mean, if you compare it with today's technology, right, we do have an international space station, and we're going back to the moon in, what, 4 years' time? And I reckon by 2035, there'll be some structure on the moon where people will be there, and it'll start from there. I hope we... I'd love to... I mean, the world of, like, StarCops could be on the round the corner now. Because when you expand outwards, you're going to need a police force. And who's going to be, like, governing it all? So, like, the International Space Police Force, which I think is awesome. They have these, like, weird, like, laser gun thing. Like, they have this pulse gun, which is sort of interesting. And, I mean, look, the effects I found were quite good for the time. I mean, Nathan Spring has, like, he basically has a Google or an Alexa. It's called Box. And it can access information from anywhere. There's conspiracies going on. The shuttles to the moon and all this. The final episode, it's something that where somebody tries to set up. There's like a big con in the final episode where they bring this artifact back from Mars to say there were life there. But then it's from Earth. They've made out that it's a big con involved in all this. And we never got the final episode after that, which was quite upsetting. David Fraser's character wasn't in the final episode because he had chicken pox at the time. I liked all the characters. I liked Kenzie. I thought the special effects for the time were very good. All right, you get past when they're in the no-gravity situation. But StarCops, you see, the BBC never gave it a chance. Now, I used to watch this on a Tuesday night. I remember at Radio Time, Law Enforcement on the New Frontier, Star Cops. And I was quite intrigued, and it come on at half past eight. And I thought half past eight on BBC Two was a bit of a funny time to put a programme out, you know. And because, like, on like, ITV and BBC One, you had, like the main shows that were on at that time where most of the country, could not forget we didn't have Sky then, and we didn't have... the internet, you know. So a lot of family audiences would have ignored this program. And the BBC, I think they moved the times a couple of times as well with the episode, which was quite annoying. So, like, I stuck with it. And then one day it finished and I found out it got cancelled about 8 months later. It just didn't come back. And I was gutted. Look, there's no aliens in it, no latex monsters, no, like, stuff like that. This is about expanding out very slowly with new technology and all these low gravity environments, lengthy space journeys, radiation exposure. It really goes into all this like stuff of outer space, which is fascinating. But the characters are really good. But like the stereotyping with like this international force that's out there on the frontier, trying to keep law and order, is that now, there was this thing, but it was 1987. So, but if you're watching it, you don't think much about that. You just accept it for what it is. Now, I could have foreseen a second season of this, you know, because I was really excited with this. I'd recommend anybody give Star Cops a go. Now, luckily, I'm like, there's been some like movement with it. Like, now we've got audio stories from Big Finish, which I'm quite excited about. I've actually ordered my first one today, so I'm quite looking forward to start tuning into this. So it does carry on, but I think the BBC really sold themselves low on this. This could have been, I think it could have been a big hit. You could have got 4 to 5 seasons out of Star Cops, because I think people, if it had been put out at say 9 o'clock. Or 10 o'clock, you know, on the hour at a certain time, I think more people would have tuned in, say 8 o'clock BBC Two. People have probably gone from EastEnders. And yet again, you know, from EastEnders straight over to that, you know, 8:30. But they didn't because there had been like a quiz show on or something like that, which really, they just killed Star Cops off. It never got a chance. And with the interviews with the cast, they were all quite gutted. Now, you have a lot of talented writers on this, you know, and the stories are very good. I mean, you know, David Farrell, Colin Davis, Pal Kenzie, Anna Shoon, Alexander Kravenko, he was the Russian director who turned up in one episode, knew what the Americans were up to, but didn't sort of explain things. And it's quite a sad beginning, because when Nathan Spring, his wife gets, or his girlfriend, she gets murdered. And, you know, he investigates it all because he don't like, he's such a good copper, like his boss says, you're going up there, whether you like, you either resign or you go up there. And he does. And he turns it into this capable force to deal with stuff, you know. So it is an amazing series. Now, could there have been a season two? Damn, yeah. Yeah, hell yeah, there could have been season two. And because it would have been set on Mars. We'd have gone out to Mars, you know. And there might have been bases in the asteroid belt, like asteroid mining, you know, and there was so much potential where they could have gone with this, you know, and they could have had a story arc as well with some big corporate governments conspiracy in the background, or a secret military base on Mars where they're experimenting with weapons and all kinds of stuff. You could have gone into this, and police corruption. The potential of StarCraft was amazing. And maybe, just maybe, as you got right through to like a 3-4 year run, in the final episode, they find alien life and it finishes there. Not aliens themselves, they find some structure, it's abandoned. They find it on a moon somewhere. And they're all like, you know, governments at world are fighting over it and carrying on that it belongs to us. And the StarCraft end up getting in charge of it. I mean, you could have gone... I think you could have done that on the final episode, like a whole new chapter. The solar system opens up. But it was scientifically quite accurate for what it was. And it was written by Chris Boucher, the first 5 episodes, which, you know, I just really loved this show. But luckily, some of us have kept this thing alive, you know, which... I'm really happy about, because a lot of the younger generation will never have heard of StarCraft. And it's one of them BBC classic series that could have been so much more than what it was. I could have seen like 45 episodes, like a 10 season run with BBC back then, but I could have seen 45 to 40 episodes. And, you know, it's been such a waste, but I'm glad Big Finish have stepped in and started doing audio stories. So I'm looking forward to buying these and listening to them. There was no memorabilia for this. It's a shame, really, because I did think about building one of the uniforms. But I did do something stupid I did years ago. Now, when it came out on videotape, I bought both videos and I got a badge. It was one of the ISPF badges. And I don't know what happened. So I didn't think about it at the time. It was in the video. I just put it in a cupboard and forgot about it. And then, because I've been watching this, I thought I could build one of them costumes quite easily. But where do I get the badges from? So it came out on DVD, which I have a copy on DVD. But the DVD's gone for stupid money. I mean, it's not cheap. It's over 30 quid. And do you know what I mean? I saw a copy of it in CX, it was £28.99. I've seen it on eBay going up to £50 just for DVD. But there is a love for this series, and it's a masterpiece of science fiction. Remember, like before that, years before that, BBC did, I think it was Moonbase 6, and it was quite serious, but they dropped it because they said it would have, that were on Saturday night, but they said it were a bit too serious and all that. But they were trying to go at it from the human point of view. The one that sense of humour in Moonbase 6, I've seen a couple of episodes. But with StarCraft, you've got these amazing characters and there's a sense of humour in it. And that's what I like about it. You know, like I said, if you get, just forget the stereotypes, that's the way it was back then. You know, what is made is here, it's done. And so you move on. But StarCraft is something special. Now, could it have been a classic? Bloody hell, it is a classic. StarCraft is a classic. It's one of the best things that came out of the 80s. Because there was a time when science fiction was just being put in the bin. You know, the ending of Doctor Who. We got a couple of years with a drought. And StarCraft came in, so end of that time frame. And for me, it kept the dream alive of science fiction. And look where we are now, science fiction everywhere. But I think Star Cops could come back. I really do. I think somebody put the money where their mouth was and got some fantastic writers in. I think Star Cops could be an amazing series. I really do. Because the potential's there. And they were going to go as far as Mars. And it would have been great to have seen, like, the Mars bases and the colonies and all that. And the people out there. Probably when Nathan Springs turns up on Mars, the police force is corrupt. He has to clean it all up, you know. And it would have brought even more characters in. Now the backgrounds and that, the uniforms are a bit clean and all the scenery is too clean. I suppose it would be a bit rough looking, you know. But they answer some great questions, like nuclear waste gets fired towards the sun. And, you know, it's like they're sort of dealing with these sort of problems of what's going on Earth. But this series, it was 20, 30 years ahead of its time with some of the stuff in it, like Box's Alexa thing, you know, what he talks to and it talks to him, you know. So Star Cops, the characters were awesome. The writing was brilliant. Look, you can get past the effects. I think the effects at the time were amazing. You know, it were all, it's like they're trying to get as scientifically possible down to the details they can. But if you're expecting laser guns, space fights and aliens, you're not going to get it in this. You're going to get a sense of humour. You're going to get people in this situation that have to live in this environment and deal with dodgy situations. And that is the beauty of Star Cops. It's policemen in space, you know, but dealing with like normal crime and weird crime and corporate crime. It covers so much, and it does like the mafia exporting uranium back to Earth. It's sort of really interesting, you know. But in this one, because the Cold War was going on in 87, it's like you've still got the tension between Russia and America and all this. And then you've got this international committee that runs the whole space frontier thing as well. They're caught up in the politics of it all. I mean, there's so much in this program that you could have just explored it for so many seasons. So I'm gonna say, is Star Cops, could it have been a classic? Fuck yeah, it's a classic. It's one of the best out there, and I do recommend it. I recommend watching all 9 episodes are on YouTube. It's there for you to watch. And then after that, watch The Cult of Star Cops. It's a half an hour thing what the BBC made. They did The Cult of Blake 7, The Cult of Tripods, and The Cult of Star Cops. I recommend watch it, and it'll tell you everything you need to know. But I have a personal love for this series. I think I'd love to see it back, but luckily I've ordered the first big finish, so I'm quite audio story of it. So I've really enjoyed this review, and I'm going to get back to watching Star Cops. So guys, please subscribe to my channel, and I will see you soon. I'm back, and the live shows will be starting up, and we'll put an ad up in the next day or so. And this is it. Hopefully I can do this every week now. I've got a lot planned for this series, and I will see you on the next Could Have Been a Classic next week. So if there is, I've just got myself into the mode. So like, you know, it's been 2 weeks. I haven't made a YouTube video. So guys, please give this a share, give it a like, and let me know your thoughts on Star Cops, you know. And I'm going to get back to episode 4 and be ready. Oh yes, one thing, the music. I forgot the music. Right, yeah, sang by one at Moody Blues, can you believe it? There's a lot of love hate for the music, you know, Star Cops. You know, the music, there is a lot of love for it. I love the intro, it's quite amazing. And it's fascinating, the whole sort of like the foot, you know, the foot going onto the lunar dust. But that music, do I hate it? Do I like it? I noticed when I first started watching it, I didn't mind it. And then after a while, it started annoying me. But the music identifies Star Cops for what it is. And what a fantastic intro. So please, guys, that's everything covered. I've been all over the place on this. I've not made a video for 2 weeks. And I will be more focused on the next one. So, guys, please tune in to Solo One Sci-Fi Podcast. It's online now. My partner, Coakley, he puts a lot of work into it. So, you know, best to him. And next podcast will be next week. And the live shows will be coming on Sundays. I will stick up an ad for that in the next 24 hours and let you know the date. So, guys, stay safe in lockdown and have a happy lockdown. Just watch Star Cops, you know, and that's it. I'm going to say live long and prosper, and I will see you on the next video.